Yo, what's up, beautiful people of YouTube? Welcome to Dom's Media Zone. Today's tutorial is a part 3 out of a 4-part series of tutorials on Adobe's Lightroom, the CC version or the web-based cloud version. So this is part 3. In the previous 2 parts, if you haven't seen them, I'll put links down in the description. In part 1, we talked about basics such as navigating around Lightroom, adding photos, creating albums, using presets and all the automatic functions. In part 2, we covered lighting and color sections, so I showed you how to use all of those. And in this tutorial here, we're going to cover the effects, the details, the geometry sections, and also the crop and rotate section. So if you're new to Lightroom, this is a beginner's tutorial. Stay tuned and enjoy. Hey everyone, welcome to the 3rd tutorial. Today we're looking at Lightroom, and this is the web or cloud-based version of Lightroom. And last time we looked at adjusting the colors and the lights in a photo, and in today's tutorial we're going to be looking at the effects, the details, and the geometry sections of Lightroom to show us what they do. So if you missed last week's tutorial, I will put a link in the description to part 1 and part 2. Part 1 was basically just about navigating Lightroom, importing your photos, and using presets and the auto functions. Part 2 was about light and colors. This is the 3rd part about effects, details, and geometry. So let's jump straight into it. So I've got my photo open for editing. I'm going to open the effects section over here. As you can see, we've got texture, clarity, dehaze, vignette, grain size, roughness. This applies to the grain. All right, let's begin with the texture option down here. So the texture option, if I move it to the left all the way, you can see it kind of hazes up, makes your photo a bit more blurry, takes away that fine texture of the photo. Increasing this all the way makes your photo extremely clear and extremely sharp. It's very similar between texture and clarity, but I'll show you something. Clarity, if we bring this all the way down, also hazes up your photo, but in a bit of a different way. It didn't make it as dehazed as the texture did, but increasing the clarity makes it super sharp, super clear. But there's a problem with doing that. If you zoom in, you might not see it when you're not zoomed in, but increasing the clarity, as you can see, introduces a lot of noise into your photo. It makes your photo much more noisy. So be careful when using clarity. Use it just as much as you can. So for example, if we increase clarity to 30 as an example, you can see some of the noise appearing here. To counter that, we would normally bring down the texture. So bringing down the texture counteracts that clarity, that noise. So you could use those together, or you could just use them separately, however you like. So let's say we increase the texture and increase the clarity. You can see now your photo becomes super clear, super kind of sharp, but it does have a bit more noise in it. So up to you how you want to use it, but I like to usually just increase the clarity until my photo looks kind of good. So let's say 30 in this case. You can see everything's super clear now. And then what I'll do is I'll bring down the texture a little bit, maybe to about minus 20, to kind of get rid of that noise. It's still there a bit because our clarity is a bit higher, but it's not as bad. So texture and clarity make your photo much more clearer. So this is the before, this is the after. Now I do apply before I start editing lens corrections. That's why when we do the before and after, you'll see that your photo, kind of the structure of it, changes a little bit. So before I work on any photo, I just do lens corrections so that Lightroom can automatically choose the best setting for my photo already. So I do that first before I do anything else. Now moving on to the dehaze option over here, if I bring this all the way down, you can see it hazes up the whole screen completely. If I bring this all the way down, it kind of removes all the haze completely from the photo, and even the clouds, you can see detail. There might be like a bird or something flying up here. You can proper see details you couldn't before, but I mean, this is too dark, it dehazed it a lot. So usually I do increase this up a little bit, maybe till about 30, and that looks kind of good for this photo. Up next, we've got something called the vignetting, and vignetting lets you basically, moving it to the left, it gives you these dark corners around the edges. Moving it to the right makes them very bright. So if you wanted to use this effect, if you're creating some kind of photo, maybe with someone's portrait in it, this might be a good effect to use. But in a photo such as this one, I won't be using it unless your corners are really dark. You could then use this to brighten them up a bit, but in this case I'm not going to use this, but that's what it does. And up next, we've got an option option called the grain. So this is if you wanted to give your photo this kind of old school grainy look, you could increase the grain. As you can see, it just introduces a lot of grain into it. And then over here, you can adjust the size of the grain. So you could literally make it very grainy or very fine grain, or you can just leave it at default. And then the roughness, if I decrease it, it makes it a bit less rough. And if I increase it, it makes it very rough. So look at this. If we do that, you can see it grained up our whole photo. So if you were going for this old grainy look, you could use that. I don't really use this, so I'm going to reset everything by double clicking on the grain. And that's the effects tab. So effects tab is done. Now we've got texture, clarity, dehaze and vignetting and the grain. One cool thing here is there's this little eye here. Every section has this. If I press and hold down my mouse button, it takes away what we've just done and shows you the before and after without those specific effects. So already you can see we made the photo a bit more clearer and a little bit more good. And I haven't even adjusted the light or the color tab. We're not going through that today, so I left that section out completely. And that's the effects section. Now we're going to look at the details section. So the details section is your sharpening and your noise reduction and color noise reduction. So sharpening, if I zoom in on something, let's say over here, there's some kind of satellite dishes over here. If I sharpen this photo, you can see every single detail now clearly, but as well, because I moved it to its maximum, it made it super sharp, which introduced a lot of noise into the photo. By taking the sharpness all the way to the other side, you can see it's not as sharp anymore right now. Use sharpness until you feel your photo looks good, but then let's say for example 90, I can still see the noise around here. That's when I would use this noise reduction. So if I increase my noise reduction now, you can see my photo is still super sharp, but the noise has been reduced now. So also you can increase this all the way to 100, but then it also kind of sometimes makes your photo, it loses some of the sharpness. So just find a good balance between the two. I usually put noise reduction at about 50 to 60 if I go up quite high with the sharpness. Color noise reduction would be similar to noise reduction, but it would be to do with the color. So basically, I don't know if we have an example of this, but move to the right to reduce color noise. So move it to the right if you want to reduce color noise. I don't really think we have too much color noise in this photo. Let's try zooming a little bit more to see if we do. Okay, so if I zoom in on this photo quite a bit, I found one part that might have some color noise. So if I zoom in all this way, if we increase this, you can see it kind of blurs out the color noise, but doesn't always work perfect. Sometimes it's better to just leave it off. If I take it off completely, you can see on the walls, there's this little color noise over here. If I increase it, it tries to get rid of it. So use this one if you've got a lot of this color noise on your photo. In my case, I don't really have so much, so I might just leave it at about 35, something like that looks good. So all this detail section is to do with the sharpening and the noise reduction after you've used the sharpening. Okay, up next we're moving to the geometry section over here, and the geometry section is used to kind of move your whole photo around to change the perspective of the photo if you want to get a bit creative. So let's say distortion, you could bend your photo inwards or outwards. Let's say you wanted that fisheye look, you could do that over here. I don't use this section a lot if I'm being honest. You've got like vertical, horizontal, you can change by moving left to right, you can stretch your photo vertically, horizontally, you can rotate your photo this way, that way. I usually rotate my photo using the cropping tool, which we'll go through as well. Then over here you've got an aspect ratio, so you can make it a bit thinner, kind of stretch it this way. And over here you've got the scale, you can make your photo smaller or bigger, zoom in kind of thing. And you can reset by double clicking, offset the x axis, offset the y axis, and that is your geometry section over here. So if you want to move your photo, kind of change the way it looks, you could use this geometry section over here. And those are the three sections we just went through: effects, details and geometry. Lastly, we're going to look at this crop section, and then in the next video I'll have a look at the remaining two sections over here. So the crop section is nice because you can kind of choose how you want to crop your photo and you can straighten your photo. So say for example we think this photo is a bit skew, you could find a line that's kind of straight. Let's say for example this building line over here, we want to make that straight. So you could adjust that to your photo by moving this left and right very carefully until you're happy with the way your photo is positioned. If you're happy with this, you could just click this again and it straightened your whole photo out for you. Alright, also if you want to crop your photo, let's say for example we want to just include this building in this photo on its own, we could crop it that way, but you'll see something here called the constrain aspect ratio. If this is locked, your photo is always going to maintain the ratio of the frame. So if I lock that, it's always going to be this ratio that it is right now. But if I unlock this, it will let me adjust it freehand however I want it. So if you unlock that and say we just wanted to crop this building over here like this for example, and if we click the crop button, you can see we've cropped only this building over here. If I click the crop again, I can just go and undo my whole crop if I wanted to. That undoes my adjustment as well where I straightened it. So there we go. Let's redo the straightening. And then let's say we want to maybe crop this a bit this way. And we could possibly remove this building, but this building's nice. So let's leave it. Let's do something like that. And if we're happy with the crop, we click on this again. And there we go. It cropped our photo to how we want it. Clicking crop again, you can see you can rotate and flip your photo with these buttons over here. Flip it to the right or to the left. Over here you can basically mirror your photo, so if you click on this, it inverts your photo and mirrors the image the other way around. Sometimes this is good to use for portraits and things if you find someone looks better the other way around. I don't know, it's a good option. I don't really use it much, but it's there if you need it. And then you've got flip vertically. If you've taken a photo upside down and you need to flip it, you could come here and just flip your photo around. And that's how the cropping section works. To undo everything is here. It's the reset button. Also over here you've got something called the aspect ratio, and here you can choose your aspect ratio. So say you wanted a 1:1 like a square photo, you could click on that and it gives you a perfect square where you can now drag your photo around in the square to choose that aspect ratio that we've just selected. So for example, let's click on that. Now you see our photo is 1:1 perfect square. So you can choose your own aspect ratio here, or you can choose one of these predefined ones. You can either enter a custom one or as original or as shot, which is how your camera took the photo in the first place. And that's basically the crop section. So I'm going to end this tutorial here. In the next part, we're going to go through this healing tool and this whole masking section. This section is new over here, this masking section. This is the new version of Lightroom, which just updated a few days ago. It's the version 5 of Adobe Photoshop Lightroom. So we'll have a look at the healing section and the masking section in the next part. Hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Thank you for watching.
Thanks for watching part 3 of this 4-part series. The next tutorial will be uploaded shortly, and I hope this did help you out, and I hope you learned something new. If it did, do give me a thumbs up and do subscribe to this channel. I'll be making loads more photography and media related content in the future. So thanks for watching, stay safe, take care, and goodbye.